So, is polyamory or monogamy more natural? Well, proponents of monogamy tend to argue that polyamory is just clearly unnatural. If it were natural, then why would we experience such intense feelings of jealousy, possession, fear, inferiority, insecurity? They also look to non-human animals who practice monogamy. You may have heard that about 90% of birds are monogamous, and this is technically true, but a bit misleading. Because what's meant by monogamy, when applied to non-human animals by biologists, is quite different than what the average person means when they use the word. You see, non-human animal researchers distinguish between two, sometimes three, different forms of monogamy. Well, there's sexual monogamy, which is what most of us usually mean when we use the word monogamy, and this refers to the practice of exclusive sexual relationships with one other partner. But this is extremely, extremely rare in non-human animals, as we'll see. There's also social monogamy, which refers to exclusively living with one other partner and cooperating for things like searching for food, finding shelter, caring for the young, etc. In addition, some biologists also make a distinction between sexual monogamy and genetic monogamy, which is the practice of reproducing exclusively with one partner, but still engaging in sexual and social relationships with other partners. Now, when biologists use the term monogamy to describe the habits of non-human animals, they're generally referring exclusively to social monogamy, not sexual monogamy, not genetic monogamy. So, although, yes, it's true, many biologists have identified many different animals as being naturally monogamous, this does not mean that they are having sex exclusively with one other partner. For instance, gibbons usually keep the same mate for life, but they are not sexually monogamous. Complicating things further, unless explicitly stated, biologists are usually not referring to lifelong exclusivity with a single partner, but rather to the practice of a succession of exclusive relationships, what they refer to as serial monogamy. Now, some argue that humans are serial monogamists by nature, but even this claim is rife with contention. Black vultures are sexually monogamous, but only while their offspring need care from both parents. The same goes for emperor penguins. Although they are sexually monogamous for a time, approximately 85% of emperor penguins find a new partner every breeding season. And further complicating things, the definition of monogamy when applied to non-human animals generally does not refer to strict 100% monogamy, but instead to mostly monogamous or monogamish couplings. Now, there are some examples of non-human animals who practice lifelong, strict sexual monogamy. Hornbills, for instance, or Azarus night monkeys. But it appears that there is no creature more monogamous than male prairie voles. Male prairie voles are strictly sexually monogamous for a lifetime. In fact, the male prairie vole is known to attack any other female that approaches him after having sex for the first time. Researchers have indicated that this behavior is linked to a hormone present in the brain of the male prairie vole called vasopressin. Now, when the male prairie vole mates or cares for its young, vasopressin is released. To test the effects of vasopressin, researchers have injected vasopressin receptors into another, more promiscuous species of vole. And, as anticipated, following the introduction of vasopressin, the hormone, the promiscuous voles were seen to exhibit strict monogamy. Now, to bring this back to humans, vasopressin receptors can be found in the human brain as well, and they vary from person to person. Perhaps this is why some people prefer monogamy and others don't. But there haven't been any reliable large-scale studies observing the correlation between vasopressin levels in the human brain and a preference for monogamy or polyamory. Now, on the other side of the spectrum, we find bonobos and chimpanzees. Now, these are the closest genetic relatives of human beings. Bonobos and chimpanzees are non-monogamous. They mate 1 to 4 times an hour with up to 12 partners a day. Researchers indicate that they have sex not just to reproduce, but also to bond. They have sex to say hello, to say goodbye, and when they're stressed out. And this is why, like humans, they face each other during sex, unlike almost every other mammal. Now, like humans, chimps and bonobos also exhibit what's referred to as female copulatory vocalization. This is a fancy word that means moaning. Moaning almost exclusively is found in primates that engage in sperm competition, which means that there are multiple sperm donors or males who are having sex with a single female. It's suggested that the moan is an invitation for other males to compete for the opportunity to mate with this female, and that human females moan for this exact same reason. In fact, it's presumed that the head of the human penis is shaped as it is in order to evacuate the sperm of competing males. We are more closely related to chimps and bonobos genetically than chimps and bonobos are related genetically to any other primate. Now, many advocates of polyamory argue that human beings, like chimps and bonobos, are genetically non-monogamous. And we were all the way up until the agricultural revolution, when they say that the concept of private property was first invented. The agricultural revolution took place about 12,000 years ago. So this is only about 6% of humans' total time on Earth. But there certainly is some debate around this issue, as there's very little evidence and lots of speculation from both sides. Some human groups still do practice non-monogamy today. For instance, the Mosuo, an ethnic group from southwestern China, where everyone is completely sexually autonomous, and children are raised not by the mother and the father, but by the mother and her family. Also, the Bari, an indigenous group of Venezuela. In this group, it's customary for women to sleep with multiple men, and they believe that the child will inherit the qualities of each man the mother sleeps with. So, if the mother wants a child who is musical and brave, she can sleep with a drummer and a hunter. Every man who sleeps with the mother is considered to be the father of the child and jointly helps raise the child. Franklin Vo, author of More Than Two, A Practical Guide to Ethical Polyamory, argues that humans are naturally polyamorous, but they're also naturally monogamous and naturally asexual. Humans are remarkably variable compared to any other animal, and therefore, comparisons really can't be made. He remarks that humans are naturally left-handed, naturally right-handed, ambidextrous, black-haired, brown-haired, bald, polyamorous, monogamous, asexual, aromantic, and that attempting to make claims about how we should or shouldn't act is unnecessary. We should instead be investigating our own intuitions and our own desires. Now, all of these claims about whether or not polyamory or monogamy is more natural fall under the domain of the appeal to nature fallacy, or the naturalistic fallacy, a logical fallacy in which an attempt is made to argue that a thing is good because it's natural, or bad because it's unnatural. Just because something is natural doesn't make it right. Many things are natural. For example, murder exists in the animal world and is natural. Violence exists in the animal world and is natural. You could say that non-consensual sex exists in the animal world and is natural. This does not make it right. Making presumptions about the rightness or wrongness about a thing based on whether or not it's natural has been used to justify the unequal treatment of gay people of color, of women, and others for centuries. So this entire argument about which is more natural, polyamory or monogamy, may be best to ignore and instead spend some time on some introspection and finding what works best for you as an individual.